Thanks very much for inviting Adriana and myself to talk tonight. And can we turn these down a bit? Is that okay? I suppose what we're going to do is just do a little bit of housework around it. I think we're going to talk about how we met and the project in general, look at some of the single images, and then probably conclude with Adriana's video. And then hopefully, if we don't go on too long, open up to the floor and tease out some of the issues that that the work kind of brings forward. But I should also just do a few thank yous. We do have Julia Martin in the audience today from Photo Fusion, who instigated this kind of dialogue and was one of the first people in the UK to say yes to the project in terms of helping Adriana deliver it as an exhibition. Also, David Drake at Photo Gallery in Cardiff. Both these exhibitions are on now. I mean, his support has been vital to the project as well. And also Sarah Chapman and the team at Plymouth, where the show will be opening up in mid-June. So in many ways, just some logistics, the project is over kind of three chapters, and each time the project is kind of manifesting itself, it's changing slightly per space. So if you haven't seen the show in Brixton, it's on till, Julia, you have to remind me, till Friday, so there's a great opportunity to see the work then. If you don't see that show, Cardiff is only 2 hours away on the train, and if you miss that, then you should really make the journey to Plymouth, because there will be some exceptional work on display then. But Adriana and I, we met in Houston, Texas, at a photo fest, and I was reminded today it was 2004. And part of that portfolio conversation, which I think you've been doing similar things this week, was is that my role was to sit across the table and Andrea's role as a photographer was to present her work to me. But we ended up having a conversation about her first project, which was the Tangle work. Could we throw an image up? You know, I mean, classically, Adriana had been working on this for a while, and it might be just good to go through a couple of the images, which I think had not been completed that long. But in the as we were talking about this project, it became clear that Adriana was working on something else, which was much more complex. Well, let's just say different, not just different, not more complex. So we ended up having a conversation really about the whole idea of Adriana's relationship to the Malvinas Falklands conflict, which for me kind of resonated really quite heavily, being someone who around about the age of 22 in 1982 really probably was my first mature war, if you like, as an adult thinking about conflict. Number one, as a young guy, not really knowing where the Falklands were. Number two, been very much seeing this conflict through the prism of Thatcherism. And number three, feeling as though that somehow there was a degree of kind of political injustice around this space, around what this war actually represented. And in many ways, that on both sides of the conflict. So looking at it for me, once we began to start talking about this war, let's move to one of the images from there. Looking at this whole idea of how we actually dealt with this idea, how we actually thought about what, you know, photography and conflict and war was about, and looking at what Adriana had done as an idea of creating a more symbolic gesture through images around how we resolve these questions of kind of conflict, and how in many ways it was a backdrop to ask some, after we talked for about 20 minutes and some time afterwards, how the project in its sense was really a kind of backdrop to address this question of resolution in conflict and difference, really. And I suppose how that was underpinned by the very particular political kind of resonances that were at play across the forces that were at work in the world at the time. And I was seeing this very much as a process of looking at it through the prism of both Reaganism and Thatcherism and the whole idea of the kind of uber nationalisms that were really at work across the world at that time. So, I mean, Adriana, I suppose the first question really, I suppose, is I think it would be really interesting to take people on your journey to that place.
Well, and in Argentina at the time it was the military junta, so it was a dictatorship, and for us it was also a very difficult time. And you know, they were in power in 1976. So in 82, they were losing ground, and you know, a lot of people have the perception, and I think rightly so, that this conflict, in a way, was used as a means of remaining in power. And so the fact that it didn't work out was what brought democracy back to Argentina. So there's always been mixed feelings around these issues for the Argentines. On one hand, you know, it was the only war that we fought in the last two centuries. And for me in particular, the conscripts who went to war were pretty much my age. So it's something that was very close to home. I was then living in Buenos Aires. I moved to New York the following year. And so when I first started to work on this project, was actually from a journalistic point of view. The idea was to work on a feature for a magazine, and we pitched it through my agency, Contact Press Images in New York. Robert Pledge is the editor, and he contacted the London Sunday Times magazine, which they thought it was quite interesting to have a story told through Argentine eyes and British words and see what happens 10 years later. At the time, Argentine citizens were not welcomed in the island, so, you know, my visa was not granted. And what we ended up doing is I worked for 2 years basically with veterans of war, and the story got killed. So I had to wait 10 more years actually to start working on this subject again, and I did it through what we're gonna be seeing now, which was an expedition that I was hired to work on for the National Geographic. It was a documentary to find the remains of the war cruiser General Belgrano, and just to give a quick background information for the people who don't know about it. I know that a lot of you know about it, but it was the first big event during the war. The cruiser was sunk and 323 people lost their lives, and from then on everybody knew there was a point of no return, that the war had started. It was almost half of the Argentine casualties of the whole war, so until today that remains a very traumatic and painful event. So what I was hired actually to do three different things, which was be the still photographer for the documentary, and because we wanted to make sure in case we didn't find the cruiser that we had a human story to accompany it, which was one of the most fascinating aspects for me, and the whole work stems from that episode actually, which was to get together two survivors of the sinking of the Belgrano, and two crew members from the HMS Conqueror, which is this nuclear submarine that sank the Belgrano. So my role was not only to interpret, but also to facilitate the communication, to make sure that they were getting along, and they, you know, that they were just the human end of the story. So it worked actually very, very well. I mean, we were all very anxious until, you know, the parties met. There was a very big difference in rank. It was on the Argentine side, there was the second commander of the Belgrano and a captain, and on the Conqueror, there were two ratings, which is just sailors. But they weren't just sailors, because one of them was actually the one who hit the second torpedo that pressed the button that sank the cruiser, and the other one was one of the first people who saw it through the periscope. So they were emotionally very attached to the story as well. We spent 15 days in the open ocean, and this work that I'm gonna show now is what started pretty much the whole visual concept of my work. My contract was such as that all the photos that I was taking during the expedition belonged to the National Geographic, so I shouldn't keep any of those, but whatever I did that had no reference of the expedition was mine. And this is how this body of work came to life.
So was there already a sense that you were going to be doing something else with this at
well,
this point?
Probably, because it was evidently very connected emotionally, and it was hard to feel that once we arrived to Ushuaia, that was going to be it. So after looking, I mean, usually when I work on a project like this, I come back, this is black and white film, by the way, and I look at the contact sheets, I never like what I see, so I need to put them away for 3 months or so and look at them again until I start seeing things. And then I realized that these images of the sea were really retelling the story in a metaphorical way, from the moment of impact to abandoning the ship to trying to reach the raft, the disorientation, the pain, the mourning, the loss. And then I knew back then that I wanted to end up in a note of redemption, if you know, that was the whole title, Voices of the Tempest, the sinking of the war cruiser General Belgrano and redemption in the South Atlantic. Probably because the experience between these people was so positive and so strong, It made me realize that if for former enemies, it is possible to find common ground and understand each other and acknowledge each other's pain, which is the first big step in basically connecting to each other as humans and realizing that the cultures may be very different, but the issues are the same. And the pain is the same and the loss is the same.
And so it wasn't about sides at that moment, it was about the experience.
It was pretty much about the experience. After a while, I decided to do an installation because I realized that the voices, I was also in charge of conducting the interviews on the Argentine side. The director in DC felt that being a woman and Argentinian, I had a better chance to connect perhaps a bit deeper emotionally with the survivors. So he invited me pretty much in a very free way to ask whatever I felt was appropriate. He just gave me a couple of guidelines of things he needed to have, and the rest was like just a conversation. And I then knew that I was going to do something with testimonies as well. That was,
So this is the first outing as the work outside of the National Geographic Commission. What did the National Geographic do with it?
They did a documentary for TV that was aired here in the UK. It was aired in the US, of course, and in Argentina, and perhaps in other countries, but those three for sure. I mean, we did not find the remains of the cruiser, which in a way it's there is no closure, and it's also metaphorical to the whole conflict that there is still no closure. The pain is there, the wounds are open, they're closing, things are being re-examined and represented, but it's still, as we know, pretty much open. This is actually in Houston, and you know, it was after it was presented in Argentina. And at that point, I thought this was going to be it. I showed this in Buenos Aires, and that's it, done, which, you know, it felt good because my first project took 15 years to do. So I figure a year, 2 years is perfect. And then I basically stayed in Buenos Aires, and I was visiting the exhibition, and I was able to actually see how it was received And that was what moved me and inspired me to keep working on the project. The fact that people were walking into that room thinking they were going to see something, and all of a sudden they were seeing something totally different than they expected. And they were very pleased because the work did not force them to stand on one side or another of the conflict, but rather it was pretty open-ended and everyone could position himself, herself, whatever they wished. And people were writing very moving entries in the book, and it almost felt like a cathartic experience. But in
Buenos Aires, was it mainly seen as a kind of the tragedy around the Belgrano in this instance? Was it memorialized as a project, or was it offering closure? Because I think this kind of work in many ways can either do two things. It can reveal the underbelly of the kind of political situation which caused the tragedy, or it can begin to just become a memorial where people lament the loss of the individuals involved or imagine that loss. So what was the overriding function of the work in that moment, do you think?
I think it was both, because through the writings, evidently some people were very upset about the military dictatorship and they were expressing that, and they were blaming them basically for the loss of these lives. So, which I thought it was very interesting that at least when you present this kind of work with Argentina, it's almost like the enemy within. People do blame the military junta for the war, basically. And
I think that's a really interesting point, though, the whole idea of the enemy within, because I'm just wondering how that manifests itself on a UK side through the experiences of the people at the conflict, whether there was this sense that there was also a betrayal or a sense of an enemy within or being used or not been looked after, because there's a sense of the role of the state in this is a really, on both sides, is an important question, I think, which underpins some of the foundations that resonate through this work. How did that manifest in the UK side?
Well, I don't feel it the same way in the UK side. I feel like you're right, most people have no idea where the Falklands were. But they felt it was a British war, a war they had to get involved. So I think in that respect, it's perceived differently so far. But you have to tell me, what do you think the perception here is?
I'm not sure. I think there's a degree of... I think it's the time and recollection on this is a really important perception. I think that there are those that are very close to the conflict, but time, you know, shifts it again, looking at it as an anniversary project. I think it's really interesting to look at the Falklands War now, for me personally, in relation to someone who remembers it, because of kind of what's going on now. And I think that there are things that the Falklands War and the Malvina conflict can tell us about how we operate both as kind of a nation state and how we respect those that are involved in those conflicts afterwards. And I think some of the things that are revealing themselves from my engagement with the project around those that were there kind of haven't, you know, the echoes of that are beginning to surface from those that have been, you know, who've been in campaigns in the Falklands and Iraq and other places. So I think these kind of, I kind of wonder whether the lessons, how the lessons are learned through these stories. And the reason why I think this particular project resonates is because of so much, how much time has been spent on it and how much due diligence has been. I'm very aware of the fact that when we speak, you're very, 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 very sensitive about balance, this question of, and I think within that whole idea of how we take responsibility and represent both sides of a situation and focus it through a kind of human story rather than through a kind of what's right or what's wrong, or a moral story or a nationalistic story, is really what underpins the questions that arrive in this work. I don't think it's necessarily about the militarization of Argentina to try and go on this bizarre campaign, which we're never really prepared for. But at the same time, the stories of the militarization of both spaces is really important to that, because the Falklands Malvinas conflict almost saves the Navy, if you like, in the UK. And the conflict is designed to try and save the nation, if you like, in terms of Argentina. So they resonate. Well, if you peel back the surface on this particular moment, they resonate quite strongly in both the national psyche. You could argue that this campaign gives Thatcher her second term. And during that second term, the Conservative Party consolidate their new face of the UK. It's at that moment we begin to recognise that the Tory Party is no such thing as society campaign. Itself manifests itself as a truly formed new ideological perspective which will change the face of the UK forever, which is underpinned by this conflict. So I'm trying to tease out from you really the local, if I look at this then in terms of being able to put this work on in Buenos Aires or in Argentina in a new democracy, it must have encouraged lots of new voices or to feel confident about what they were prepared to say about the past. And we know how violent that past is in terms of its local, you know, presence on people from the disappeared through, you know, various forms of political oppression. So I think this is why I think for me the show is so catalytic. It opens up all these other avenues through people's personal experiences that are not necessarily obvious when we look at these sets of images in that way.
I totally agree, and Argentina is known for, you know, always polarizing. You know, you're either for or against, and it's really very hard to find a space in which people could agree to disagree, if you wish. And I think this is what this work is proposing, like to include rather than exclude, to look at each other as humans, which it's a novel approach, I tell you, in this conflict, at least in Argentina it is. And I think to include all sides, because we're talking about the Argentine side, we're talking about the British side, and we're talking about the Falkland Islanders, because when people deal with this issue only from a political perspective, there are only two sides. It's Argentina and the UK, but from a human perspective, it's really the three sides and what happened. Although, you know, now it's trying to become that in the political arena, but it's not quite flying like that. But as a work, as an artistic work, if you wish, just because it's not purely documentary, it does have evidently a documentary.
Well, tell us about this first outing, what people were doing in this thing, because there's some particular things happened during the show, well, as a kind of construction, really.
What fascinates me, or what intrigues me, or what I'm curious is surviving, and what happens to survivors, you know, just what is it that keeps them alive, how they survive after they survived a traumatic event, what are the qualities that a survivor need to have to be able to keep living? Because evidently everybody has those mixed feelings, the ambivalence. Yes, they're happy to be alive, but they're so sad of all the friends that they lost, and how do you cope with that? So that's why the raft, what intrigued me initially was those 36 hours from the moment the people left the Belgrano until they were rescued, about 36 hours. And we're talking the South Atlantic, which is one of the roughest oceans, and it's, you know, extremely dramatic, and waves 10 meters high, and they were in these rafts. Actually, this raft was it ended up being a gift from the Argentine Navy to me for the show. Which is very interesting. For me, it was a very challenging experience, because I had to work through my own prejudice myself in order to truly get the results that I feel are important to get and to convey. And so I started with me, and.
So what was the biggest challenge then in terms of those prejudices?
Well, the biggest challenge was after this was presented in Argentina, actually, one day in New York, I received a letter, you know, big envelope with a lot of stamps in it, and it has the Navy seal of the Argentine Navy, and I had no idea what that was about, and I still have it, of course, and I opened it up, and it was a beautiful handwritten letter by an admiral. But at the time, I even asked my husband, how high is an admiral in the rank? The admiral is the man. And then, you know, I Googled it and I realized this admiral was the chief of the Navy in Argentina at the moment. Mm. And basically what he was telling me, he was thanking me for the show because it kept the memory of the Belgrano alive. It presented the way in a different perspective, so people were able to interact with the work in a new way. There was a shift in the perception. All of a sudden, there were people were lost, and it wasn't just about the dictatorship and the war. And he was very grateful for that, and he said, if you ever come back to Buenos Aires, I would like to meet you. And so I did call him, and I went to visit him, and I think that was my first big challenge, to walk into that building with all that represented the Argentine Navy for us. It was the biggest, the first and the biggest. And so, you know, he was formally dressed in his white uniform, and I went with my jeans, and this was 9 years ago. And he was like really standing tall, and then he goes like, but you're so young. Mm. I was like, what? Thank you, you know, and all of a sudden it was a different sort of conversation. He expected, you know, me to ask certain questions, and I was asking different questions. Like, for example, why did it take 36 hours to rescue these people? You know, I took the trip, I knew the distance, I knew how long. Why did it take so long?
So was there always this sense of kind of being worried about exposure, of failure from that? I mean, because there is an issue there, isn't there? I mean, unfortunately, there's this question of, you know, winners and losers in this perspective. So there's a kind of hierarchy of that. But then, I mean, ultimately, most of the people that I've talked to about the process, there is a sense of loss because of fallen friends. And that's the part that brings the story together, really. And that's the part where people begin to share their experiences. I mean, moving on, because I'm aware of time.
Yes.
I'm just thinking, you know, moving on past that kind of intervention, what happens after that, Adriana?
Well, I'm going to speak just quickly about this, because what I ended up doing is I taped the testimonies of three survivors, and within the raft, people go inside the raft and they hear the testimonies. But because they're in Spanish and this was in Houston, I developed this concept of a black box, meaning what's been recovered after the accident. And so you open the black box and you see a scrolling, you know, the translation of the testimonies. And then after that, it's this piece that relates also with something I did now for Cardiff in the UK. This is called 324, and it's the 323 people who lost their lives in the incident and the ship itself. And each single square or rectangular actually has a name of a person who died, with the date of birth and the date of death being the date of death, the same one for everybody. And it was a very moving piece. And I did it because I realized that when I was going through that list, it wasn't 323 anymore, but it was truly 1 + 1 + 1 + 1. And I realized I knew a lot of the relatives of people who have passed away, and because of that encounter with the admiral, I was invited on the 25th anniversary on a ship of the Navy to just go to a symbolic place with survivors and relatives and just lay wreaths. And you know, when we got to the destination, everything was so strong. I mean, the emotions were so strong. The mothers were shouting at the sea and they were crying, and it was just, for me, I just got paralyzed and I couldn't almost take a photograph. And that is a liberty that I had all along through this project, had this been an assignment as a photojournalist, you have to detach yourself from those feelings and just, you know, document it. But I allow myself to do that, and I was basically just absorbing it all and did almost no photography, but this piece is a result of that. And then for years I've been willing to then have the two sides on the same grid. And it is because my friend here, Tony Davies, a Welsh Guard colonel, who's a very good friend of mine and, you know, is here today supporting me, you know, that I became to feel the bombing of the Sir Galahad in a way, emotionally, in a similar way to the Belgrano, connected about that tragedy on a personal and human level. So I decided to do what it's now in Penarth, in Cardiff, which is a grid of 504 with 499 names of everybody who died in sea-related incidents on both sides. And it's in alphabetical order, and something that's, I think, very moving is, first of all, that they're all together. Secondly, that there are even some Argentine last names that are of British or Welsh or Scottish descent. So sometimes you read the last names and you don't necessarily know, and if it's Argentine or British. And when we had the opening, because of the documentary, Martin Brown, who's this person from The Conqueror who fired the second torpedo, we became very close friends and stayed in touch. And when he came to Cardiff for the opening, and when he saw this piece, he was like, because all of a sudden the 323 plus everybody became a reality for him. Him being in a submarine, you know, it's just, you do that. You had no idea what happened. And, you know, it's not like hand-to-hand combat where you are aware of the consequence of your actions. And for him, it was like...
So really, at this point, you become a kind of facilitator in both camps, you could argue. There comes a point of taking responsibility, because there's a journey there, isn't there? In terms of the Argentine Buenos Aires Houston show. And then there's a journey to another place, which begins to reconcile, literally stitch together those two spaces. Should we talk, I mean, let's talk about that place, because then there must be this sense of, there's this Argentine woman talking to these British military personnel about stitching the conflict, stitching this wound together, you could argue.
Okay. Well, I was going to ease my way into that, but I think I'm talking too much. So, because we
No, well, ease, I mean, go where you want to go. It's fine. I think we have time.
Okay.
I'm just want to move to the... Because this is quite a profound piece, this piece, in many ways, because it does bring... It is the first instance, maybe in terms of thought anyway, where the different sides begin to manifest as the same space, and it becomes a kind of humanizing kind of moment, if you like.
Yes.
Where different, the difference in the different sides within the conflict become less important.
Yes, it's true. It's true. I mean, sorry, I just said before going to the people, you know, you know, just working the same metaphors through landscapes, you know, starting with the seascapes, which is where my journey and the journey of the war started. Everybody had to sail.
So these are the islands themselves.
So now they are the islands themselves. And the reason why I shot color was because everybody thinks of the Falklands in black and white. And I just want to just let everybody know that when I speak English, it's the Falklands, and if I speak Spanish, it's the Malvinas, and that's the way it is for me. I don't go Falklands, Malvinas, Malvinas, Falklands. I mean, I just want to...
Clarify that.
You know, so... So people's memories of the time are in black and white, and the idea is to bring some color to the story in terms of if we are hoping for some sort of resolution and bringing to the present a different sort of outcome, or at least an invitation to perceive this in a different light. It had to be color. So what I did is I basically visited most of the places where the battles took place and tried to find metaphors. I mean, in the islands, you basically have rocks and tussock grass. That's all there is. So it is a challenge visually to find within that landscape an emotional landscape that could be represented. So, what I would do is, in many cases, because people do not drive there after the sun sets, because there are too many bomb craters and the terrain is very difficult. So I was very aware that if I wanted to get the shots of sunrise or sunsets, I had to sleep there, and that's what I did. I camped in the battle sites, in pretty much all of them, and each trip, I took three trips to the islands, and each trip I had the courage to stay longer by myself and basically just experience what I always felt, because most of the battles during the war were fought at night, so I always felt that the following morning was the painful time. So for me to have to experience that morning after was very important. So it was also a way of inducing fear, because, you know, when you're there and it's peacetime and nothing happens and it looks beautiful but a little disturbed, then something had to happen. And that's what I was doing. And by the way, I also want to acknowledge a couple of friends who are here tonight. And, you know, I acknowledge Tony and Joe. John is another Falklands veteran, and Steve Shaw is another Falklands veteran who I just met, and we're getting to know each other, and it's very important for me also that he's here. And there is Rob Burnett somewhere who is a Falkland Islander and is living now in London. So thank you for coming, and of course all the friends who are here, and the new friends. But okay, so again, the Falklands War is also a very interesting case study, because it was the last conventional war in which it was fought hand to hand, and it was the first war in which laser guided bombs were tested. So it was like the end of an era and the beginning of a new one. So it's incredible how such a short war, so sharp, it's metaphorically so charged, and it has so many, right?
So this material was still very evident, obviously, just left there untidied. It becomes part of the just daily experience of walking around if you choose to be on these sites.
Yes. I mean, this is an Argentine sleeping bag 25 years later. And so some images are a bit more metaphorical, and some others are, you know, this is an Argentine boot, but it's also what's telling us, you know, I mean. This is Harriet. This is Mount Longdon. This in Mount Longdon is where, you know, the heaviest casualties on both sides, and really the place where it's been fought. You'll see it later. It's really the size of four tennis courts, and that's where everything happened, and there were a lot of people there. So this was an Argentine bag where they were sending the rations to the mountains. And this is the Argentine cemetery in the islands, which, you know, part of it had to do that it had to be built in a place where people wouldn't see it from anywhere, because the local people did not want to be reminded of it. So this is between, it's in Darwin, near Goose Green.
Are they marked graves?
Well, some of them are and some aren't, and that's actually a very good question, because that in itself is a very painful aspect of these. There are a lot of, which is also very symbolic for the Argentines, that there are a lot of non-identified people buried in the same place, and that it has echoes for the Argentines, the NN, right, sort of common grave. And actually, Tony is now helping a group of Argentine veterans to see their dream is to have everybody identified. Mm-hmm. And that is a very difficult, you know, procedure, really. And it involves some degree of reconciliation to have that happen. And they're being very active in trying to make that happen. And so it's been some improvement, let's put it that way. We don't know, but it's been some improvement.
To take us through some more of the landscapes. I mean, these are all kind of results, really, of the war and how it's impacted on the space, really. Each image has a particular resonance. It's not just a sample of the island. I mean, these are bomb craters. They're objects there. So they carry this kind of lament forward, really.
They do.
How do people respond to this who are coming across it for the first time that you've encountered now, in terms of the audiences that you've seen here across the two shores? I'm kind of aware of time, because we've got about 10 minutes left before we want to open it up. So I'm trying to get you to talk about the way that the work, I'm trying now to get to a point where we talk about the work does in terms of the now. So how are people responding to this, Adriana?
I think people respond very positively, because it's a balanced view. It's about the human cost of war and the tragedy of it all. It's not about a political agenda, but it's about taking a stand for peace and reconciliation. It's not about the map, but the landscape, really. So I think people respond positively in that respect, and they're surprised, and so far I think people see within this landscape the scars and the reconciliation aspect of it, because, you know.
I mean, but there is now this tradition of the aftermath, isn't there?
Yes.
In terms of, it's almost become another kind of documentary tradition now, is to get the big camera out and get to the field and let's make this aftermath image, because photographing and pools and the way that images from wars in Vietnam are no longer possible. Is that a criticism? Do you feel as though it fits in with that tradition, or is this moving that through somewhere else?
Well, I think
because it's almost as if the gallery and the aftermath photography sit together quite nicely. It's almost as if there's a deliberate sense to hold the audience in that
bigger picture outside of the traditional magazine space, or
becomes a reflective art moment. I wonder how we reconcile that tension across audiences.
Yes, well, it definitely has a tension and mixed feelings about it, because it's very hard to, that's why I'm very careful when you say, yes, it's an artistic work, but it's really, I'd rather talk about author, because, I mean, to me it almost feels uncomfortable to use that word in front of this tragedy, really.
It's an interesting point, though, isn't it?
It is.
what do we do with that sense of tragedy and then the aesthetic, the aestheticization of those kind of moments? And it's almost as if there's become a formula now of making these kind of traumatic sites available to digest within a kind of white wall environment.
Well, I think
which have the capacity sometimes to not give us, to not, because I mean, this project for me demands quite a lot of audience work. It does actually. It needs you to do a lot of reading. It needs a lot of time in terms of the testimonies. And I sometimes wonder whether the, I mean, I think the audiences will do the work, but I sometimes wonder whether that's a big ask for audiences to kind of come away with the sense of the work that needs to be done within the gallery.
I think it's important that the audience does the work. I think it's important that people take the time. I think it is part of our responsibility also to do that and to get ourselves informed and to question ourselves, how do we feel in front of this? I think it's a very important aspect. You know, being spoon-fed, it's not really something that contributes to anything. Because after, you know, and that's another aspect with these kinds of work. At some point, it's a little bit of a personal exploration, and then it's the issues, and then the work has to take off and just become a contribution. And that's the kind of legacy and work that it's for it, you know, and just see what happens and how does it serve. To me, part of why we chose the spaces we chose to show it, it was very important to find the right space. So sometimes commercial galleries feel like they're not the right house for this kind of work because you don't want, I don't want these to be viewed as pretty landscapes that, you know, you could put behind the sofa at home.
But it's also really difficult to place projects like this in spaces like the Imperial War Museum, for example.
Yes, it is. It is, as we know. We tried. They were moved, but then, I don't know. I mean, I don't know what happens. I think it would be important for them to also move a little bit with the times. I mean, I have the privilege of spending a whole day in their archives, and I went through every photograph they have from the conflict. And, you know, it certainly, this could be a very important addition, I believe.
Because it's a different, it's a different kind of image bank, isn't it, in terms of where it sits. I mean, it's a kind of an image bank that asks us to think about the past and take responsibility for the now.
Yes.
Let's talk about testimony a little bit more, because I think it's really, really important that the voices then become part of the, because there's a, let's move on quickly with some of the photographs through the landscapes, but at the same time, if we can, let's just kind of interject with this whole idea of testimony, because there's been a huge amount of information gathered and stories told and experiences relayed that underpin this project massively.
Yes, I mean,
which hasn't really been fully unpacked yet. Because I think if we get the book out, which we probably will, it will manifest itself there. But let's talk about that, those dialogues, because there's been some pretty profound engagements and revelations and almost confessions in those moments.
Yes. The testimonies, I mean, I've been collecting testimonies for eight years now. And of the three sides, as I said before, and I think that is really the flesh of this project. I mean, people, with some people I spent a lot of time, with some of them I could only be perhaps once or twice, but with some key people I really did spend a lot of time on different trips and just getting perspective and listening. And I think, as you said, some were confessions, like what we're going to hear in the video. I think particularly on the Argentine conscript side, there is this big pain that they carry around of being brought into the country through the back door, not being recognized, being labeled crazy and, you know, never getting the care that they should have received, and, you know, not having jobs, not working, being discriminated. And so that has been changing lately. I think now even their pensions are pretty good now, actually. And this government has given them, you know, a very good pension for the first time, that they are able to actually have a very good quality of life.
There's now a kind of political recognition.
Yes, now
of the kind of contribution. In
that respect, I don't think from other areas it hasn't. I think it's still, the issue is being used to way too much for political purposes, and that is very upsetting. So the intention, exactly with these testimonies, is for them to create their own voice and choose how do they want to present themselves to the audience. And some of them, you know, kept some secrets for 25 years.
So these secrets, is it probably the first time that anyone had given them any proper opportunity to reveal these experiences in that sense?
Well, you know, I mean, depends. I mean, they have been documentaries made for TV, and it's interesting. Like, I think on the Argentine side, you could say there were somewhere between 10,000, 13,000 people on the ground. And, you know, you usually hear 5 to 10 voices, and that's it. And the same voices over and over. So I think that just to find new voices, it's important. And I think some people did speak for the first time. People who were directly involved, some relatives who lost, their children had spoken for the first time. And so then...
But I want to talk about as well how you've built these portraits and why these... Why you've done this particular type of portrait? Because it's quite stylized in a particular, you know, and there's a uniform kind of presence from them all.
Yes, after the initial stage, because this project really has been growing and evolving and expanding through the years with the intention of creating different layers of meaning that we'll convey in the book eventually. Mm. And so once all these metaphorical or analogies were created through landscape, it was important to start having faces, finally, and stop being so anonymous, and these are the people. So what I looked was mainly for people who either had some sort of connection before, during, or after the war. So we'll go quickly about it. And all of these people that I have portraits, of course, I have their testimonies. And I have more testimonies than portraits, because initially I was just taping them from a video camera, and some people passed away. Yeah, so unfortunately then we won't have the portraits for these. Carlos Castro Madero was a captain. He's one of the survivors of the Belgrano who came to the expedition with us, and with Martin Brown, the person from the Conqueror who fired the torpedo. So I tried different things. Some worked, some didn't. The idea of the tight portraits is for people to just basically focus on their eyes and, you know, just who they are without any information as to social class, no background. Everybody has the same black background, and just to see them as people.
But there's been this evolution of pairing as well, hasn't there?
Exactly. So, like, these two go together, like, you know, Filippi, you know, it's an Argentine pilot who had to eject because he was hit and survived 3 days, finally was found by Tony Blake. a Falkland Islander who took him up to his house. And there was most of these have like very nice human stories behind, and how, you know, in this case it was a question of also being civil in a very uncivilized time, and finding that common ground. So if you wish, it's almost reconciliation on the spot. I mean, it happened then, didn't have to wait 30 years. This is David Morgan, who I think is one of the more decorated British pilots, and he downed three airplanes of one squadron of four. Hector Sanchez is the person, the only one who survived, and they are now friends and they know each other. And in fact, Hector got behind David, but his weapon did not fire, so he could have killed David. So their relationship is also very interesting and important. And Carlos Cachón was the person who dropped the bomb on the Sir Galahad. And Simon Weston, which obviously everybody knows him in the UK, is a Galahad survivor. And at some point, he had the need to meet the person who caused this. And a documentary was made. And
Well, it's interesting. Simon's become iconic, hasn't he?
Yes.
In many ways, he becomes a symbol of survival through his personal story in that way, which is interesting, really.
And,
it's often the case, though, that the conflict gets through the prism of, say, one person, it becomes that story.
Yes, there is the face of, so on the British side, it's definitely the face of the Falklands War, I believe, Simon.
So these pairings, did you begin to facilitate them just because of their experiences? Or?
Yes, sometimes they knew each other from before, and sometimes I got them together for the first time. So initially I was also asking them to handwrite a wish to each other, and the wish had to be a personal wish. And everybody did it, really. I mean, in the end, I still have not found the place for it, but it was an exercise. It was a way of taking action. You know, and doing something, just take it out of your head and do something with it. And it was an exercise in reconciliation, which everybody participated actually with a very open mind. I mean, Beto is paralyzed, you know, he lost a lot of, half of his head and one eye, and he's paralyzed, half of his body, so for him, all of these exercises were very interesting to write, as it was for Simon to write down just the motor skills. And Vincent is a paratrooper who participated in London and actually was in charge of the prisoners and took one of the important photographs of him, Louise, and they met then, and I got them together 20 years later. You know, and I still serve as a facilitator. You know, they don't speak English. They write an email to me. I translate it. I send the email to them. And, you know, and it's quite fascinating. John Fowler is a Falkland Islander, you know, and a very good friend of Rob and myself. And, in fact, on my first trip, that's how I met Rob, who was living with John. And John, you know, we were in London 10 days ago in Photo Fusion looking at the show. And in that photograph of the house with the cloth lines, you know, that photograph represents how the Falkland Islanders would put clothes in the lines of the Navy, the British Navy would stop bombing them because they felt that people were not living in the houses. And you know, it was in John's house that the only three civilian people died, three women, of the whole casualty. So unfortunately, when we were in front of that photograph, John said, well, that didn't help me, did it? You know, and it was sad. So, you know, I think for him to be here and to go through the work and have the conversation we had afterwards.
Do you want to fix the feedback?
Sorry.
Okay, well, Adriana, I'm aware of time now, so we're going to have to... Should we move to the video now?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay, well, let's just talk a little bit about the video and then do the screening, yeah? So then... Begin. Then the question of how we relay this again to the whole public side of it, because the video now has become an important element and in an increasingly larger presence in the show as we move it to another space. And there's a particular kind of pace around the video. Do you want to talk about that? What the intentionality around it? Because my first impression of it was. I was ambivalent about it as a piece of work. Is it moving? I don't want to say too much because I think we can talk about this afterwards. Is it moving us in a particular direction? Is it kind of, is there an objective space to kind of interact with the stories on it? And what kind of devices are at play that we should be aware of within the construction of it?
Should we talk about this before or after?
After.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I guess they're going to do it from there, right?
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. So it's about 12 minutes, 10 minutes?
10 minutes.
10 minutes.
So I close this, right?
And I'm going to sit here and watch you talk. I can't get scared.
Yeah. Pinned down by a mic. I find it extremely difficult to talk about the intensive experiences I had in combat. There is a physiological reaction in my chest. I feel sick and tense, and it's not a very pleasant feeling, and I don't enjoy discussing that intense experiences.
Just because you've gone to war and you've come home, that doesn't make it go away. You know, that's not the end.
When a person was faced with an enemy face to face, it's him or me. That's the primitive bit. There's no room for discussion or negotiation. And it's savage because sticking a bayonet into someone is savage, or shooting them at close range is savage.
Imagínate un piloto, solo, con un solo motor. Cruza 300 millas del mar adentro. Se encuentra con un avión reprovisionador de combustible. Penetra en una flota, en donde tiene que pasar la defensa de los Harriers, la defensa antimisil, la defensa con cañones, lograr apuntar, lanzar la bomba, pegar y volver a hacer todo esto, pero al revés, salvarse, aterrizar en condiciones meteorológicas normalmente muy malas y que la bomba no funcione. ¿Qué nivel de frustración genera eso? Y eso sucedió. Y sucedió muy seguido.
I was very, very angry and I was determined to kill the pilots. I wasn't cold and dispassionate, I was extremely angry. I was killing pilots, I wasn't shooting down aeroplanes. And I don't like to admit that.
Yo creo que es un héroe, no hay muchos, son los que van mucho más allá del deber. Yo jamás me he considerado héroe. No somos todos héroes. Sí, fuimos soldados que hicieron todo lo posible por cumplir con su deber.
They were always coming in from the hills. Quite often very, you felt a bit sorry for them. They looked very cold, hungry, dirty, you know, which was understandable. They were digging in the peat, didn't seem to have enough food. So then they would stop people outside and ask people, can you buy me some chocolate or buy me some biscuit?
Pero era por acá que me estaqueó. Ahí fue que hizo un clic mi cabeza y dije, no, no va más. Ahí me volví loco. Y bueno, yo dije, yo de acá, de alguna manera, tengo que salir. Y fue que me disparé la pierna. Que es esto que te estoy contando, lo oculté 25 años.
Fear that you will die or be badly wounded. Fear that you will let people down by virtue of the fact that you're not doing your job properly. And fear, this is particularly for a commander, that your actions will result in a lot of your own people being killed. I think General Mendes did the right thing by surrendering.
Mi general, tenemos que asumir responsabilidades históricas y finalmente, si usted no puede hacer nada más por esta guarnición, yo creo que en pocas horas esto va a ser muy difícil y yo me voy a hacer responsable. Así terminamos. Y si no tiene nada más para mí, corto y fuera. Y corté.
By virtue of that decision, we didn't have to fight our way into Stanley and the population was saved from many more of them being killed and injured.
The problems I have certainly stem from the direct action which I took and the results which I saw. And knowing that the guys that I killed probably would have been really good friends in any other situation, which just seems a real waste.
Is there a cure for PTSD? I think there is a way of living with the pain. I think the pain is part of the experience, it's part of life.
Espero que no me pase nada. Que algún día no se me salte la chapeta y me mande una macana, qué sé yo. Como le pasa a muchos pibes, que por ahí, qué sé yo, te hace un clic así y cambias. Yo espero cambiar, pero para mejor por ahí.
I have enormous respect for Oscar. Oscar is the most highly decorated Argentine soldier, incredibly brave man. And I know that he's struggling with the emotions of his combat experiences, as I struggle. Strange that we would be trying to kill each other when we have so much in common.
La guerra es una sola, la mía o la de él. Después de la guerra a mí me dejó algo más importante que un amigo. Y hoy lo tengo acá, conmigo. Me vienen a visitar, a ver, me conocen mi familia y yo estoy contento. Contento porque él, veo que él estuvo mal y hoy lo veo bien.
I think reconciliation is necessary and I think we need to do it. And I think it helps. And I think that often it doesn't happen because of prejudice on one side or the other. And there's no reason why we can't do it. I believe that it helps reconciliation. It helps people to understand. And also, surely, it would help perhaps remove this wish for it to happen again in the case of some people.
Hello. Most of your experiences were obviously between the Skyhawk pilots and the experiences of the British pilots and the land-based forces. But there was an awful lot of people lost their lives at sea in the ships, and that seems to be sort of missing here. Or do you intend to carry on with that and pursue the sea side of the battle? Because there's a lot of people went down in the Belgrano, for instance, they didn't see the islands at all. And the same on the British ships. A lot of the sailors on the British ships, both the Merchant Marine and the Royal Navy, did not see the Falkland Islands, but some of them went through some quite traumatic experiences.
Sure, no, absolutely. Well, the greed that we saw, that piece, it's really a tribute to all those people. And I do have testimonies of people who were in the ships on both sides. I have enough of the Belgrano, well, not enough, but I have like four, perhaps. And I do have many on the British side as well. It's sometimes hard, you know, to edit, you know, on a...
Oh, it wasn't a criticism. I was just wondering if that was another...
No, it
thing
exists.
In your intentions to yes. go on and progress this.
Yes, yes. Somehow, sometimes you feel like you have to complete a body of work because it's been almost 9 years. But I know that although I may complete a book, perhaps it will never finish because, you know, I created friendships and this also occupies a space in me at this point.
I think unfortunately there is, it's about how you capitalize on a time, and there is an anniversary, and to bring it into public in that way probably meant, I think the challenge for doing a book is to make this not necessarily about those anniversaries, is about that more inclusive kind of space. Each time I look at this project, I think actually the exhibition and the public display of it is only just a way of having a dialogue about what could the content be. And I think that's an important thing for what I think an exhibition can do, is how do you encapsulate it? Where do you begin it? Where do you end it? And the big fear within a project like this is what do you leave out or what do you miss out? Because each time you encounter a kind of public experience of it, there's always that moment where it almost can't be inclusive. And I think the bits that are left out are almost the bits that are as important to the people that are identifying the passages that are missing. So it can't be comprehensive in that moment. I think it'd be impossible. Because when we put the book to bed, there will be an immediate part of what, again, could be added to that story. Other questions? Do you want to wait for the mic?
You said earlier that, was there a point at which, if you were Argentinian, you weren't allowed to visit the Falkland Islands?
Right.
So if you were a relative of somebody that was buried, as in an Argentinian who had a son or a father that was buried on the Falkland Islands, you weren't actually allowed to go to the Falkland Islands to pay your respects?
No, you were not.
You always would, the parents or family members of deceased people were always allowed.
Oh, they were? Okay. Yeah. All right, but that
My recollection is the first, but yeah, it's good that you know. Is
you
the
allowed, it was only after 1999 that any Argentine citizen was allowed, but before that, any family members of deceased.
So you applied for a visa?
There were organized trips.
What I remember is a couple of planes that actually the Red Cross, they were charter of relatives. I don't know if there were five, but perhaps three.
That was the first one.
But
you had to be part of the organization.
Exactly, it wasn't...
You couldn't just...
Yeah, I don't think you couldn't just go. It had to be an organized trip, right?
It appears so. Okay.
You can't just go even if you're British. It has to be organized.
Yeah.
They can, but they have to be
That's so it's a, not an easy trip.
No, it's not.
Not an easy trip. There isn't an easy jet to the Falklands. Okay. Can I take your question, please?
I was wondering if you could have Cameron and Kirchner here. What would you tell them?
If I would have
Cameron and Kirchner generally the governments?
I would love for them to look at this video and realize that there are other avenues than, you know, but like I often say, you know, politicians have their agendas and they are playing their part. I don't think anybody is not playing their part, unfortunately. Of course, it's important to insist on the human side of it, but will they listen both sides? I'm not sure. I mean, you know, this buys a lot of things for both sides, unfortunately. And so that's why I think it's important to have other alternatives that will make that less powerful, if you wish. You know, and where people would just find those common grounds. But, yeah, I would love for them to see. You know, we're talking about people, really.
What do you think they'd say?
I'd probably tell them to get around the table and stop fighting over resources and talking to people.
Okay, any more questions? I'll take this one first, and then I'll come to you.
Something striking about the recent controversial Argentine movie that was filmed of a sportsman covertly on the Falklands was the Falklanders' complaint that there was an absence of their presence in that video, that you know they were wiped out, they were invisible, which actually not just chimed with, you know, perhaps an Argentine view of the islands as, you know, populated by colonial interlopers, but also a British view that there are just sheep and tussock grass and penguins, an absence of the islanders. And perhaps the photographs, the landscapes, could reinforce that image of barren islands, that even the house with the sheets, the islanders are represented by inanimate objects rather than themselves. Is there a focus, by focusing on the 75 days of conflict, is there a lack of visibility of 200 years of Falklanders' history on the islands?
Well, I don't think so, because their voices are going to be very present, and as they are the portrait. So I think within the concept of how this work is being conceived, I think the islanders do have a presence.
I'll come to you next. Do you want to come back on that, or are you okay?
No, okay. Please.
Let's take your question.
Adriana, you said something that got me thinking about how you think of yourself as an author, and not necessarily as an artist. And I'm sort of wondering how you see those distinctions. Are those distinctions important between author, artist, documentary maker? There are artists who work with the subject of war, like I'm thinking of Frances Torres and Jeremy Deller, and sometimes very well. So I don't know. I mean, are these distinctions important to you? Should they be important to anybody?
That's a great question. I mean, I believe, because I've been basically a photojournalist for 25 years, and, you know, somehow it's something personal. I don't think they should be important. I think if you do social work, that's what's important. The work is important, because it's not really about is it me, is it him, is it an art object. What is it about is really what I think is of essence. But yes, it is something that I deal with in that respect, because, I mean, basically that's how, you know, I studied in the school of Robert Kaplan, social, you know, documentary concerned photographer. So all of a sudden this transition, it has me a little bit on a shift. Yeah, it's being redefined. But is it important? Probably not. What's important is what you do and the function of the work.
Do you still have your question? And then we'll come. Actually, do you mind if we take this question first, just of convenience for the mic, and then we'll come back there?
I'm sorry, I know that I can always talk to you anytime, but Adriana, you're a good friend. I did know how powerful your work was, and I want to congratulate you on that.
Thank you.
And I just want to follow up on the question that someone else asked before. This is a very powerful thing, that what you're creating, what you're bringing both sides together. And to me, it really creates a sense of responsibility on your side. How do you see that, Adriana? Because the issue is highly politically charged, and you're coming to something, and I wonder how you can handle that, or how do you see yourself doing it?
Yeah, excellent. Well, the first choice that I made was to finance the project myself, and I think it was the best choice in the sense of freedom and dealing with the work in a responsible way, because we all know, particularly journalists, that the context is crucial. I mean, the work in the wrong context means something totally different. And just to have that control, or, you know, the way of where is it going to be presented and how is it going to be presented, is very important. Although we had a piece in the Sunday Times, and it was very well done and very well respected. I mean, you know, the work was shown in the right context, the way it was meant to be shown. And it is a responsibility, indeed, and I take it very seriously. And I think that it is precisely that aspect and just the inspiration of the people that I'm dealing with that keeps me engaged, motivated, you know, because it's 9 years. 9 years, you know, where I have a family, I travel, you know, I spend a long time, you know, away from my family. I spend a lot of money on it. So yes, I think that's the way I deal with it, just by trying to have as much independence as possible, and then have the right associations with the people I know, like Mark, like Julia, and the people I know will respect, you know, the integrity of the work and not use it in a different way. That's very important.
Can we take this question at the back, please?
I'm kind of with the last question, actually. I just wanted to make a comment to open it up that you've been a woman, you've followed this as it's evolved, and you have been with men who have opened up to you, who have been in positions of being able to influence the forces both in Argentina and in the UK. I just wondered whether there was any point you wanted to make around that. It seems phenomenal to me that there are so many men who have been so emotionally engaged through the crisis and through their experience of talking with you and with each other.
Yes, well, thank you. I think it is indeed, perhaps, it did make a big difference in terms of my work was precisely on the emotional side as opposed to the tactical aspect of the war or the political. So I think it was unexpected. That somebody, like, for example, General Thompson or even General Menendez, you know, they've been giving interviews in 30 years to so many journalists and people, and I believe there are very few things they haven't been asked before, and I think the fact that they remain engaged and kept receiving me was precisely because they were never asked about this aspect of the story, the human, the emotional, and I think those invitations from writing the letters to the mending of the portraits were, they just thought it was very unusual, something they could have not conceived, and they were curious and they felt it was challenging and they wanted to participate. And the fact that they want to collaborate like that, it's just phenomenal, really.
I'm not sure what's underpinning the question around gender, but there's maybe another issue there.
I don't think there was anything underpinning it because that would be boring. But there is something, I think, special about the fact that you're a woman, you're a family person, and I wouldn't want to underestimate it.
No, I appreciate. Yeah, my family is very supportive, and you know, and they are part as much as possible. They are part of it. I remember when the first time I showed Voices of the Tempest in Buenos Aires, you know, my son was, I don't know, perhaps 8 or 9 at the time, and he was playing with the son of one survivor inside the raft. It was like a game to them, and it was, you know, pretty poignant because, you know, it was actually someone who was a conscript that we had a lot of friction over the years. And for me to all of a sudden see my son playing with his son, it was a very interesting experience. And I think that's what I value about this work, the possibility that creates of integration. So I don't know if, you know, there is any gender, but I think it's a possibility that creates of inclusion that I find it very, very important. And my son's birthday is May 3rd, and the Belgrano was sunk on May 2nd. So it is quite interesting because I take it as my responsibility to whoever I met on that day or around that date to make contact and speak with them. And we always knew that around some anniversaries, I wouldn't be for his birthday, let's say, because I would be, you know. And it was always...
I think it is a core question around the project, the question of responsibility. I think it's kind of quite a demanding... I think there's a kind of... There's almost a kind of charge in that place. It's like, what do you do with... You know, how do you facilitate? Do you, you know, there's been a kind of fault line, hasn't there, in much of documentary work, which has been about, you know, getting there, getting the pictures out, telling the definitive story. And because that's a very privileged and often male space that has been historically locked down. And you could argue that the whole kind of magnum ethic within that space, this is kind of contradictory to that form of storytelling. It's not about jumping off in a helicopter with a bunch of guys behind you or in front of you and getting close to the action and getting gritty about it. It is more of an authored kind of space and a story that allows a different kind of narrative to maybe surface, which time does allow. That research, I think, you know, due diligence on the research, due diligence on the kind of key stories and the narratives that are not just about, you know, the who, what, where, when, and the firepower that was excelled on the day, and numbers and statistics, but about those, you know, individual stories make it a much more profound kind of subject, one which I personally would subscribe to in terms of a way of engaging. And I think that it could be held up really as a model of encouraging people not simply to be seduced by the front line, if you like, and to maybe think about the backstory a little bit more and how that influences the front line. But you had a question. Saw a hand go up there. Let's take that, and then we'll take... How much time have we got left? 2 more questions. So we'll do... There's one there and one here.
That was very compelling and moving. Thank you. And incredible that you are able to bring people's emotions and honesty on that level out. 2 things. Firstly, in terms of responsibility, how far you push with taking people back to that level of rawness, which I've never experienced, and tried to understand people who've been out there fighting on the front line, but never could even begin to conceive. And secondly, when do you let go? Or will you never let go? Will you keep... I mean, obviously, you've made great friends, but will you continue to keep up the relationships? And then to what extent will you stop? Or are you just going to continue this forever? Thank you.
Let's take that one, and let's take both questions together.
Thank you, Adriana, for an amazing presentation. I kept thinking about the fact that you, as well as I, left the country after the war, and the distance that immigration to the US, in my case, ended up living in Britain, has provided to this project. It's very emotional, very personal, because we were there at the time, and we know how absurd the whole thing was. I mean, we were in the middle of the worst dictatorship, and suddenly these people who were absolutely mad, who were in power, decided that we were going to war against Britain. And it happened so quickly, and we saw masses supporting the generals. Yes, go to war. Like, a month after, the same people were in the square saying, get out of here, you know, dictatorship must end. All that made us probably leave the country. I remember very clearly thinking, this is mad, you know. And I wonder, if you had stayed, would this project have been the same? Would it have been possible for you to have this emotional distance and this capacity to be neutral somehow? It's not completely neutral, of course, but in that space that you are occupying within this conflict.
Well, I'll
okay,
answer.
Let's try. When do you, yes. Just a reminder, when do you let go?
Yes.
And would it have been possible,
yes,
if you had been there?
Well, I think probably it wouldn't have been possible. I think the fact that I lived in the US at this point longer than I have in Argentina, and that I see the world differently, and, you know, that's how I could get, I don't know if the distance that you need, and that goes with the other question a little bit, just to be able to put yourself on everybody's shoes. And I think that's the invitation of this work, to listen to the other. We already know our side. Now it's time to know the other side, you know, the one we don't listen. And I think that in Argentina is very difficult. I think here it's also very difficult. And I think it's extremely difficult in the Falkland Islands. Understandably so. And the one thing I learned with this project, and I remember it's something that Julian Thompson told me the first time we met, he said, you must remember that you cannot approach this kind of work judging people. And that always stayed with me, and you know, and I was doing it before, but I made the conscious effort to never judge anybody, including people that I knew I was judging before, but, you know, particularly on the Argentine side I'm talking about, and truly tried to see them as people, you know. And so, yes, the short answer is I don't think I could have done this having lived in Argentina. I think it's still very emotional in Argentina. I think that the few people who are at the moment are proposing a new way of looking at this are being dismissed. You know, like, who are these people? I mean, they're traitors. I mean, I'm sure I'll get some of that when I show my work in Argentina, probably, perhaps a little bit. Hopefully not. And if it is, it is what it is. People are where they are. The important thing is to just open up little doors here and here, here and there. And now, talking about the responsibility, because that is actually very, very important. And what I realize is that two things. With photography, it's always this question of distance. You know, Robert Capa used to say, if the photo, if you're not close enough, it's not good enough. And so there is always these questions of distance, and it's a dance almost, like between the photographer and the person you're working with, both physical and emotionally. I think that when you're dealing with issues of pain and loss, you have to be gentle, You have to be invited to people's life. You can't say, here I am and I want to know about your pain. You have to take the time and really be very gentle about it, because you're opening a Pandora's box and you're responsible for that. As it did happen with me, with the father of somebody, you know, who died in the Belgrano. I mean, he was, you know, so happy, and his wife was looking at him like, oh my God, I never saw you talk like this, it's the first time. But then he never ever wanted to see me again after that time. That was it. Never answer any more phone calls. And, you know, so it was a big shock for me. And you know, and talking to Vincent Bramley, a British paratrooper that you saw, although he wrote two books, you know, I remember after our first encounter that was so intense, so many hours, he said, you know, I have this little chain with a key that I always carry. I very rare open, you know, unlock it, very rare. I don't know why I did it with you. And he said the only one condition, and we shook hands, is that will not end up in the mainstream media, as we respect it. And he said, and I want you to know that I'm putting it back in, and that is it. And I respected that. All the other times that we kept meeting, we never went there anymore.
Well, I think we're going to conclude the evening, and I'd just like to thank Adriana for that project and its ongoing development. And do try and see the shows. They are still on. You've got till Friday in London, a month or so up in Cardiff, and then a couple of months in Brixton. But really, Adriana, thank you very much for enlightening us across the project. And thank you very much for coming along tonight.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.